Very good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the sixth lecture in the Judicial Services Examination Lecture Series 2021, Phase 2. My name is Shama Vishwani. I'm a lecturer and Assistant Dean, Career Services. And I once again welcome all of you to the sixth lecture of this lecture series. It's an absolute honor and privilege to welcome our esteemed guest speaker for today's lecture, Honorable Mr. Justice Jahangir Jamshed Munir, Sitting Judge, High Court of Judicature at Allahabad, who will be delivering the lecture on the Indian Evidence Act 1872. Honorable Mr. Justice Munir earned his bachelor's degree in political science honors in the year 1986, followed by an LLB degree from the Aligarh Muslim University in the year 1989, for which Lordship was awarded gold medal by the Uttar Pradesh Higher Education Commission. His Lordship joined the bar as an advocate in the year 1990 and practiced extensively in the High Court of Judicature at Allahabad for 27 years in almost all branches of law while being a member of the bar. His Lordship was counsel for writ petitioners in some of the celebrated cases like Naresh Agarwal versus Union of India and the Aligarh Muslim University versus Malay Shukla in the year 2006, where provisions of Aligarh Muslim University Amendment Act 1981, constituting it into a minority institution, were struck down and held unconstitutional by the Honorable High Court. His Lordship was also the senior panel counsel to the Government of India from the year 2015 to 2017, that is until his elevation as the additional judge at the Honorable High Court, Allahabad. His Lordship was appointed as a permanent judge at the Honorable High Court in September 2019. His Lordship, as a judge, has decided cases involving various disciplines of law, including criminal matters, labor law matters, consolidation and revenue matters, matters and appeals arising from civil suits and services matters, to name a few. It is indeed a privilege to have you with us today, Your Lordship. And thank you once again for taking out your invaluable time for our students. Today, His Lordship will be sharing his insight on the Indian Evidence Act 1872. And not taking any time further, I humbly invite Justice Mr. Munir to deliver the lecture, after which I will be taking up questions towards the end of the sessions. Request you to kindly drop your questions in the chat box or comment sections. Over to you, sir.
Welcome all of you, members of the faculty, students. Am I audible? Students and other participants, if any, I am not aware. Put a lecture of this kind in a nutshell, in a short span of 1 hour, is almost an impossible task. But I will try to do whatever I can make of it. The Indian Evidence Act, it was drafted, you know, way back in the year 1872, what is one of the most sterling pieces of legislation to be found in the world. It is one of the most precise legislations, and as often said about it, one of the most tersely drafted legislations. It is so precise in its phraseology that it is more than mathematical in words. Now, you know that the Evidence Act is divided into three parts broadly. First is about the theory of relevancy. The second is about mode of proof, and third is about the production and the effect of evidence. The last, we largely rely upon the worth and value of evidence. Now, strictly speaking, the worth and value of evidence goes beyond the four corners of the legislation. That is always for the court to do. But it is the last part which aids the counsel and the judge in ultimately judging issues that arise for consideration. What I have thought about speaking to you generally is about two or three sections which engage largely attention during the judicial services examination. To a few of these, I will refer very briefly, and the two I will refer in some detail. You will find that these judicial services examinations, they are designed to test your general awareness of these legislations, your working knowledge, so that once you sit in court, you do not commit a mistake on the basics. Initially, you are asked to sit as a judicial magistrate on the criminal side and as a civil judge of the junior division on the civil side. You are either trying original suits or trying these cases tribal by magistrates, whether as summons cases or as warrant cases and very few summary trials. All of these require you to have a deep insight into the Evidence Act. Evidence Act is one that applies to every jurisdiction once it is a regular court. Now, one area which you will always find that to which I will refer very briefly is about the evidence of this value of the evidence of an accomplice. There is invariably a question which almost figures always in a judicial services examination paper, that what is the value of an accomplice's testimony. Now, about the accomplice's testimony, the rule is very simple and broad. A accomplice's testimony under section 133 is admissible against another co-accused. It is one of those areas where evidence that is not otherwise relevant under the first part is made relevant under the third part. It is rather made admissible, as it is said that some at times everything that is admissible is not everything that is relevant is not admissible, and everything that is admissible is not relevant. 133 is an illustration of that. For example, about the testimony of a co-accused. Nothing is said in the part of relevancy. It is not excluded altogether, but nothing is spoken about it. But here it is made admissible. It is said that yes, it can be read. It is admissible. But it comes with a big caveat. And the big caveat is that when relying on accomplice evidence, the court has to be very careful to receive such evidence with caution. It should be corroborated in material particulars. The reason is that the accomplice has always an axe to grind. He might be trying to win an acquittal, because when he accepts that, yes, I was also participus criminis and so-and-so was alongside me, generally he is bargaining for a pardon. And then he is coming up with accomplice evidence. A person of that kind, to save his own skin, may tell also. The other is that even if he is not asking for a pardon and says something in the hope that he will get off with a lighter sentence, again, he has some benefit to derive out of that. There is a possibility that he might be just acting out of that motive. The last, of course, is that if he is truly a man with shady antecedents, not every accused has a shady antecedent. Many, many, many honorable men also get accused of offenses. But if he is a person with that, all has to be seen when receiving his evidence. What is his background and all that? If that is the case, then there is a possibility that why depend on a man who has got such shady antecedents? So an accomplice's testimony must always be approached with caution. For the principle of law is that an accomplice's testimony is admissible. There is no legal bar. But the rule of prudence is that it should always be received with caution. It should be received It should not be received liberally, should be received only when corroborated in material particulars. This is one area where judicial services examinations will always try to explore a candidate's knowledge about this feature of accomplice evidence, which time and again often comes up before young magistrates. It is not so much relevant before senior judges, sessions judges. It is not much relevant. For magistrates, it is very relevant, and that is for sessions judges also. Any judge who is doing a criminal trial, but magistrates, yes, it is all, they are always probed about it. Now, there is another area I just wanted to refer to briefly, and that a magistrate confronts sometimes, often rather, not very frequent, but often. And that is when there is a claim about property, about a person whose whereabouts are not known. You can well understand that I am talking about Section 108 of the Evidence Act. A person whose whereabouts are not known for the past 7 years by those who ought to be aware about his whereabouts, like his family members. If a man lives with a family, say comprising his wife and child, or maybe a father and an old mother, and nobody has heard of him for the past 7 years, the law presumes that from the date of his known appearance and a continuous period of tracelessness, no contact over the statutory period of 7 years, there's a presumption that he has died. It is, as you know, called civil death. These issues do arise in the context of inheritance, whether it be testamentary or it be it succession, or in some other context relating to disposition of immovable property, transactions affecting immovable property. Sometimes these often arise in the context of a kind of suits which are very commonplace these days. These are suits for cancellation of sale deeds. You are aware? Suits for cancellation of sale deeds are filed before civil judges, asking that such and such part of the sale deed is a nullity because it has been executed by an imposter. This man was dead. Somebody may say that this man was not actually dead, well, but he's not been heard of for the past 10 years by those who should have met him or knew his whereabouts during these 10 years. So the plea is that the man has met a civil death, and therefore the sale deed executed by him is indeed by an imposter. That plea does come. Now, of course, there is other evidence to judge it, the thumb impressions, the signatures, the photograph. Nowadays, there are many things to a sale deed in which in yesteryears were not there except for the thumb impression. But if somebody is able to show or is not able to show that conclusively that the thumb impression or the signatures of the man are his own, then yes, civil death becomes an important question, rather the most important question. So what would be the law about it? Generally speaking, the law about civil death is very clear. And all that it says is that the man should not have been heard of, to use the precise words of the statute, if you see. All lawyers and judges should develop the sound habit handed over generations of men of the law to read the same statutory provision over and over again whenever they are confronted with an issue about it. And I will shortly tell you the reason why it is important. You might have known it by heart, yet again you must read it. Now see, the short title of the section is 108, Burden of Proving That Person Is Alive Who Has Not Been Heard Of For 7 years. Or rather, the burden of proving death of a person, 107, to have been alive within 30 years. Now, what does it say? kindly see. We'll just turn to the board. Provided that when, this is how the section begins. It starts with a proviso, almost the words of a proviso. It is not indeed a proviso because it is in the opening part. Provided that when the question is whether a man is alive or dead, and it is proved that he has not been heard of for seven years, by those who would naturally have heard of him, if he had been alive, the burden of proving that he is alive is shifted to the person who affirms it. Kindly mark it. 7 years is the time. Now, supposing a man says that here is a deed executed by X in my favor, and the deed is said to be a sham. It would be very technical and a matter of action, of the nature of action, that who comes up with the challenge. Supposing a plaintiff comes and says that this deed is invalid because this person has not been heard of for the past 7 years by those who should have heard of him naturally. The burden would be on him to show that he has not been heard of. And then the other side would have the burden of coming forward with evidence of his whereabouts, of his being alive. Now, if that is not so, the defendant puts in a sale deed, which is disregarded, which has already been disregarded, say, by a mutation court. And the issue is whether the man was alive or not. The burden would be on the defendant to affirmatively prove that he was alive. It gives rise to reading, you know, these statutory provisions. One is left staring at blank letters. One does not appreciate them much. Why everybody is asked to read these provisions again and again whenever a question comes up before you? The reason is that these are dead letters of law. You will never be able to understand what they mean. But when you have some facts in hand, you will realize that these letters of law will have a life of their own. And every different case will show to you that there is a different angle to this statutory provision, a different shade to it, depending on the facts that you have in hand. That is why you are asked to read again and again. Because you are not teaching this provision of law like I am for the time being. When you are arguing a case or deciding a case, you have a question to decide. And then when you look into this provision of law, you will get a new vantage to it. Every time there will be a new vantage to it. That is why the seniors, they ask you to read it again. That is the purpose. How about this provision? There's a lot of law. And I don't know, you might know or not, this provision led to one of the most lengthy judgments in the history of our judiciary ever delivered. I also now forget the precise name of the case, but it is popularly known as the Bhaval Sanyasi case. It was decided in the 1940s, I think, or late 30s or early 40s, by a special bench of the Calcutta High Court. It was a full bench of three judges, and they tried the suit on the original side. It is seldom that a full bench tries a suit. But it was tried, and it was about that Maharaj Kumar who was sick and who went away with his wife to Darjeeling to recover. He was suffering from tuberculosis, and then the news came that he had died at Darjeeling. He came back, and his last rites were performed. Nobody actually saw much of the dead body in the remains. Some saw, some did not see, and then his last rites. Rather, they were performed in Darjeeling by his wife And then the news came that the man was no more. Then after more than 7 years or 8 years, suddenly the man appeared, an ascetic appeared, a Baba, and he said that I am Maharaj Kumar. The wife said, no, he is an imposter. He's dead. So amongst the hundreds of issues that were involved in that suit, one was 108 about the civil death, that he was not heard of during the statutory period of 7 years. He should have come back to his wife. If Maharaj Kumar was alive, he would have come back to his wife. He was not heard of by anyone. But then he had the explanation to offer that I had become an ascetic. Ascetics, you know, leave their family. Whatever happened, it's another thing, but it led to one of the lengthiest judgments. It was the presiding judge was Justice Costello, an Englishman, and had some very illustrious other judges also on the bench. Anyway, it was a very important case. Anybody who reads about 108 would always read about the Bhawal Sanyasi case, as it was popularly called. So this is about 108, generally speaking. But before I end, I must tell you that under 108, if the court comes to a conclusion that the man has met a civil death, there is no conclusion that he has died at a particular point of time. There is no conclusion that he has died one day after the period began or one day before the period ended. It could be any time during the entire statutory period. That is the law. Because it is constructive death. As you know, the principle of constructivity. Constructivity in law, or something when we call something constructive, is when the law, out of the existing state of facts, creates a fiction about things which do not really exist or are not really known to exist. So 108 is the rule of constructive death, deemed death. Yes, civil death it is called. Anyway, it can be rebutted. Somebody can come and show, well, I am alive, or somebody else can show that these issues sometimes have become easier because we have evidence of a far greater quality in the form of photographs, videographs, so many other telltale signs about a person moving about and doing his transactions, that it can be proven that no, he was alive. So it would be rebutted. It is a very rebuttable presumption. There is nothing conclusive about it. But one must remember that it is a presumption of law, not a presumption of fact, if somebody is able to prove it. Then the other issue that I must move on to is about another presumption, which becomes very important. And it has become very important of late because of a scientific advancement. And that is the presumption about the legitimacy of a child or the paternity of a child, 112 of the Evidence Act. These are all questions which often figure in these rose examinations. Now you know that the letter of the law is very clear. Again, as we read it, what does 112 says? It says, the short title says, you must always read the short title. It is one of the most important clues to interpretation. Birth during marriage, conclusive proof of legitimacy. Here I must pause and tell you that this, though part of the many presumptions, the charter of presumptions under the Evidence Act, is no ordinary presumption of law, because the word used is conclusive proof. Conclusive proof generally means irrebuttable. If the fact is proved, the conclusion would be watertight, inescapable. That also is defined, what conclusive proof means, in the definition clause, you know, of the Evidence Act. The fact that any person was born during the continuance of a valid marriage between his mother and any man, between his mother and any man, or within 280 days after its dissolution, the marriage, the mother remaining unmarried, shall be conclusive proof that he is the legitimate son of that man, unless it can be shown that the parties to the marriage had no access to each other at any time when he could have been begotten. This is the principle. Now you see, the difficulty is that everything was all right. The law was fairly well settled. All that you had to prove was that the idea why this section was brought in was that it was the endeavor of the society through the law to uphold legitimacy of children. Children born during a wedlock between a man and a woman were regarded to be children of that marriage. Whether there was some doubt about it or not, the law would not favor it. As they say that the law frowns upon bastardy and upholds legitimacy. It is not the policy of law to encourage illegitimacy. Therefore, this particular statute, this provision was brought in. It is based on an old common law principle. And it is very sound. There is no doubt about it. It is also in accord with our social ethos, where we strongly believe in a family which starts with a solemnized marriage according to some rites, and then a man and wife, and then their progeny. So it is in accordance with that. It is absolutely nothing to, I mean, for us to frown upon it. It is a very good provision which upholds the good values in society. Now, any child born during the subsistence of a wedlock is presumed to be the legitimate child of the two. The only thing that the man generally, because it would be the man who would be disowning, the woman also can, in a given. The only thing that lies in the hand of the dissenting party who says that no, so-and-so is not the child of so-and-so, is that the man and the woman had no access to each other during the period when he could have been begotten, which is the natural period of gestation when a child could be born. So that is the only evidence one could lead, and the law was fairly well settled. It is difficult evidence to lead, no doubt, but yes, it could be led. In olden times, it was far easier because the world was a simpler place. Somebody, if a man was sitting, there was good evidence that a man was sitting at a distance of 1,000 kilometers and the wife away on the other end of the country, and there was no movement. There was evidence that they were continuously there. Well, yes, the burden could be discharged, and then the issue of legitimacy would seriously arise. Now, a different dimension was added to it. And on this issue, you would find that young aspirants to these judicial services are flooded with questions. This is about the DNA testing. Now, DNA, scientifically speaking, is regarded to be a fairly accurate scientific way of assessing paternity. I had occasion to summon a deputy director of a forensic laboratory. The director came, there was an issue of paternity, some context it had arisen, and I wanted to, not paternity, other relationship, whether the two were brothers or not. The director told me that if you can give us the blood samples of the father and the mother, we can tell you with our capabilities, she was from the Lucknow FSL, with 100% accuracy, that these are the whether they are related by blood and they are brothers or not. Said that the Hyderabad FSL has greater capability. Supposing you don't have the father and mother, you have only one blood relation, we can predict with 50% accuracy. In Hyderabad, they can, with only blood, one blood relation, they can predict with 75% accuracy. And with the one parent and one cousin or one brother, they can predict with 100% accuracy. So I mean to say that depending on the scientific capability of the laboratory where the test goes for analysis, there is no doubt about it that the test is very precise, properly done, subject to the expert being, if somebody doubts it, he can cross-examine him. But if the expert says on the basis of his reasoned report that he can show that DNA sampling, the way he has done it, that it matches, then there is no doubt. But see the way the law looks at it. The law says, you know that questions that are essentially legal are to be decided by courts. They are not to be decided by scientists and doctors. Under this Evidence Act, you know that the opinion, the evidence of an expert is nothing more than an opinion. Howsoever high, howsoever accurate it might be, it is nothing more than an opinion. It is not the doctor who decides the paternity. It is not the doctor, it is the judge who decides it. The doctor's opinion, howsoever weighty, is only a piece of evidence. Isn't it? This is how the statute is. It has been held, there are decided cases, that as the statute stands, ultimately, whatever be the DNA report, ultimately, if somebody is able to discharge, rebut this burden that the man had no access to the wife during the relevant period of time, and a finding is recorded, the DNA report will not be able to help the person establishing his paternity. It will not be able to. Those decisions I may briefly refer to because they're important. I think the earliest was Kamti Devi and another versus Poshi Ram, 2001, volume 5, SCC 311. And it was held there very interesting decision. It was said, the result of a genuine DNA test is said to be scientifically accurate, but even that is not enough to escape from the conclusiveness of section 112 of the Act. That is, if a husband and wife were living together during the time of conception, but the DNA test revealed that the child was not born to the husband, the conclusiveness in law would remain irrebuttable. The DNA test notwithstanding, I add. Follow this. This may look hard from the point of view of the husband who would be compelled to bear the fatherhood of a child of whom he may be innocent. But even in such a case, the law leans in favor of the innocent child from being bastardized if his mother and her spouse were living together during the time of conception. Hence, the question regarding the degree of proof of non-access for rebutting the conclusiveness must be answered in the light of what is meant by access or non-access as delineated herein. I'm not concerned much about that access or non-access. The idea is that the DNA test is not a complete answer to this provision of the law, which has always been there as the law stands. The same position remained in Shamlal Kuldeep versus Sanjeev Kumar and others, 2009, 12 SCC 454. This was about succession. That was in the context of a criminal matter. This was about succession. It was succession to a Mitakshara joint family. And here also, what was held was that the presumption is has to be discharged according to the provisions of section 112 and not in any other manner. So the DNA test remains an important evidence, no doubt, but it is not a complete and foolproof answer. To the scientist, it may be, but not to the court. And ultimately, it is the court which has to decide the paternity. Those cases are not decided in laboratories and hospitals. Then there is still another decision which is important. It is very important. One must always hear. This is Dipanvita Roy versus Ronobrita Roy. This arose out of a matrimonial cause where there were allegations of adultery. So one was a criminal matter, the other was a civil matter. This is a matrimonial cause. Same provision at play in different fields that you can see. The question, this here again, the same principle was laid down. The Supreme Court, they are speaking about themselves, their lordships of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court in Nandlal Vasudev Badve, the one I was referring right now, clearly opined that proof based on a DNA test would be sufficient to dislodge a presumption under Section 112. Further, it is born from the decision, from the decisions rendered in Supreme Court in Bhavani Prasad Jena, that depending on the facts and circumstances of the case, it would be permissible for a court to direct the holding of a DNA examination to determine the veracity of the allegations which constitute one of the grounds on which the party concerned would either succeed or lose. However, it is not disputed that if the direction to hold such a test can be avoided, it should be avoided. The reason is that the legitimacy of a child should not be put to peril. And then ultimately, hence the direction. This should simultaneously be taken as the most authentic, rightful, and correct means also with the wife for her to rebut the assertion made by the husband and to establish that she had been unfaithful, adulterous, or disloyal. If the appellant wife is right, she shall be proved to be so. Personally speaking, so it was held that the DNA test is very important. It can displace the presumption, but it cannot ultimately be the infallible answer to the presumption. I don't know. Speaking for myself, I take umbrage to the, not to their lordship's words, but generally as we speak, the wife being disloyal as if she is a servant. No, the husband can also be disloyal. Nobody, loyalty is not a word which should generally be employed unless it is employed both ways. Then older expressions persist. Legitimacy of child. Then the other is this decision in Badvik, which I was telling you, referred to here. It was held that the scientific proof provided by DNA test report acceptable presumption of legitimacy of child stands conclusively rebutted. In this case, the DNA test was accepted as rebutting the presumption, but it is not that it is a complete answer. It is just a piece of evidence, and in this case, it was accepted. That is all. There's a very recent Rajasthan decision also, and where all these decisions have been noticed, and it is said that the DNA test would avoid unnecessary harassment and embarrassment to the persons involved. DNA test will bring more certainty and quietness to the issue and result in quick disposal of the case. That's all. That's about it. But the issue that still survives it, that some legislative change would be required there. Still somebody may doubt that there could be other evidence. So you cannot leave it to the assessment of a doctor, ultimately an issue on which so much of the rights turn. Sometimes it is could be life and death. At others, it could be the loss of the entire inheritance. At others, there could be some anything. So it is ultimately to be left to the court. This is a very important area. Then the last, I should have reserved more time for it, but I can see the clock ticking. That is about proof, you know, this electronic evidence. It has been a matter of great debate that when the Evidence Act was naturally placed there on the statute book, we did not even have hints of what we know as information technology today, or computers or anything. So we had two kinds of evidence, oral and documentary. Document everybody knew, and they were far-sighted enough. You will not say that the draftsmen of this legislation confined it to a written document. If you remember the words, they said that it includes a lithograph and so many other things, which would also be documents. What a document means, they said all that, whatever they could envisage at that time, way back in 1872. They foresaw whatever best they could, but naturally they could not have foreseen. So with the passage of time, after all this came in, and contemporaneously with the Information Technology Act, we also introduced the Section 65B to the statute book here on the Evidence Act. And we have provided these two provisions here. You know, Section 64 and 65, they speak about primary evidence and secondary evidence. You understand that. Now 65A and 65B, they speak about, it is a third kind of evidence. That is also, this is electronic records. The contents of section 65A says, the contents of electronic records may be proved in accordance with the provisions of section 65B. What does 65B says? Notwithstanding anything contained in this act, any information contained in an electronic record which is printed on a paper, stored, recorded, or copied in optical or magnetic media produced by a computer, here and after referred to as the computer output, as we know, shall be deemed to be also a document. This is again that constructive principle. We regard it as documentary evidence. If the conditions specified in this section are satisfied in relation to the information and computer in question, and shall be admissible in any proceedings without further proof of production of the original, as the evidence of any contents of the original, or of any fact stated therein, of which direct evidence would be admissible. Now, what are the conditions referred to in subsection 1 in respect of a computer output shall be following. The computer output containing the information was produced by the computer during the period over which the computer was used regularly to store or process information. You know all the various conditions you can read. The issue that has often arisen is that how will the secondary evidence be proved? The easiest way is that this mobile phone is also a computer. This small laptop is also a computer. There could be hundreds of devices. The word computer under the Information Technology Act, you know, is very widely defined. And that is the definition given to it under the Evidence Act also. It could be anything. So if that can be produced, if the issue is that whether a WhatsApp message was sent from this phone, the phone can be produced. And it is end of the matter. We don't come to 65B. But we come to 65B if the supposing there is a big system of computers which cannot be carried into court, as they say, and placed in the dock to be proved as a document, then what is to be done? Naturally, we rely on the paper output or the CD output in any form that the output is put, and that is secondary evidence, how that is to be proved. Now, that is to be proved, as they say, in any proceeding where it is desired to give a statement in evidence by virtue of this section, a certificate doing any of the following things, that is to say, A, identifying the electronic record containing the statement describing the manner in which it was produced, B, giving the particulars of any device involved in the production of that electronic record as may be appropriate for the purpose of showing that the electronic record was produced by a computer, C, dealing with any of the matters to which the conditions mentioned in subsection 2 relate. 2 is, I was just mentioning what is required to be shown. And purporting to be signed by a person, occupying a responsible official position in relation to the operation of the relevant device or the management of the relevant activities, whichever is appropriate, shall be evidence of any matter stated in the certificate. And for the purpose of this subsection, it shall be sufficient for a matter to be stated to the best of the knowledge and belief of the person stating it. Now, this led to much controversy. It has recently been settled by a full bench decision. Three-judge bench decision, the Lordships of the Supreme Court, 2020. The leading cases on the point, the initial view that was taken was there was this decision in Shafi Muhammad came later on. The latest decision, which is summarized the law, is this Arjun Pandit Rao Kotkar versus Kailash Kushan Rao Gurantayal and others. It has looked into earlier decisions that were rendered in Anwar PV, Shafi Muhammad, and Tommaso Bruno, which was an appeal from UP. Now, two divergent views were taken. In one set of view was this certificate is not always compulsory. There could be conditions, supposing the device is not in the control of the person. Then, its contents can be given out. Supposing there is a computer output in the form of a bill or a document which one has received, it is in the hands of somebody else. The person refuses to give it, then yes, 64B, 65B4 certificate is not required. The other view was no, that is essential. Secondary evidence of an electronic record to become admissible, 65B4 has to be adhered to. Now, this gave rise to a conflict of opinion, and ultimately this came to be resolved in Arjun Pandit Rao Kotkar. Here, the view that found favor was that it is essential to produce the required certificate. And if the person who holds the device and who has official control over it or who is in management of the device refuses to give that certificate, one can resort to all the processes of law, of discovery and inspection, to cause the production of that certificate. They are available under the CPC, they are available under the CRPC, you can get it. But so long as you don't get that certificate, you cannot lead secondary evidence based on a computer output. If you produce the computer in original, yes, there's no problem. But if it is 65B4, it has to be. Then in this case, there is a very important thing which has been said. And it has been said that our 65B is based on a English statute, which has been repealed in that country. And Canada also has legislated along different lines. They have now equated all these computer records to ordinary documents. And therefore, these kind of certificates are not required. So if the legislature were to look into it, they might make these matters easier and these difficulties might subside. But so long as the statute stands as it is, there is no way out. That certificate has to be produced. If the person who is in charge does not give it, then yes, you have to enforce it through the means known to law, discovery, inspection, summoning of records, summoning of witnesses, and ultimately coercive processes. And unless it is there, the secondary evidence would not be admissible. This is what was the last word of the lordships of the Supreme Court. And as it is said, that law is the last judgment of the last judge. So it is the last judgment. All of them are by the last judge. They are all Supreme Court judges. But the latest becomes the last judgment of the last judge. So this holds the field for the time being. Now, this is an area which to you is very relevant, because this the law, the way the law has been viewed differently in Anwar PV, then in Shafi Mohammed, then in that appeal from UP and another case, five decisions are there. It has somewhat, it appears, slightly vacillated. And then ultimately, it has been settled here with much authority. You must be acquainted with the details of the way the law has developed and how it stands. This is one issue which is every time, almost without fail, occupies at least one question which is put to these judicial services examinees, either in their written papers and maybe their interviews also. And I think that it would place the young examinees and the candidates in good stead if they acquaint themselves with this particular branch of law. The reason is that you will find that these are questions are often asked from the branches of law that are seeing a lot of cases. These cases are coming up in those areas, and there is not where there is still unanswered questions, where newer technologies are confronting the law, or the old law is confronting newer technologies. Both these sections, I deliberately took out the DNA one and this one, because in one case, it is the medical science staring at the law, and the other, it is the computer science or the staring at the law. And the law is trying to find ways to accommodate, because as it is said, that law is about everything else. It is about things other than the law. After all, we regulate other things. Law is not about itself, it is about others. So, we have just 8 minutes left. Any questions anybody would like to ask? Can't hear you. Sorry.
Apologies.
Yes, now I can hear.
Your Lordship, we are grateful for this insightful lecture, the important judgments Lordship discussed, and of course, lessons from His Lordship's own experiences. I'm confident our students feel fueled up and guided, and that the students as well as we have benefited from it. Dear students and viewers, one of the extremely important takeaway for all of us for sure is that the importance of reading and rereading the provisions again and again, and how to look at a provisions at a provision. I will now take up questions for the from the comment sections, and I humbly request His Lordship to address them. Your Lordship, there is one question that I've received over message, and that is, what is your view on circumstantial evidence? Do you believe that when there is no direct evidence of any crime, a conviction can be based on the circumstantial evidence alone?
Yes.
And provided the court weighs all the circumstances relating to a particular crime as an integrated whole, and that any missing link would be fatal to the prosecution case.
Yes, that is generally the law about circumstantial evidence, that the circumstances presented should form such a complete chain that there is no other conclusion except the guilt of the accused. If that standard is satisfied, yes, a conviction can be based. But what really happens is, I tell you, this description about what a complete chain of circumstances is, as it is often said, not a word. Here I would call it not an expression of art. It has to be realized that in court, it becomes a reality that stares at you in the face. It faces the lawyer, it faces the judge, whether the man is guilty or not guilty. And the only circumstances, nobody has seen it. It is a very difficult situation. Everybody knows that in criminal law, there is a presumption of innocence. To displace that presumption on the basis of circumstances, yes, circumstances can be very, very incriminating. But then, as it is said, that circumstances can be such that they look very incriminating, but with all human fallibilities that we possess, we might be mistaken. Therefore, while not going into fantasy of doubt, we should entertain and examine every realistic doubt that is thrown and test that chain for the infallibility of it, whether it does. Normally, judges should not speak about cases that they decide. But I remember I did decide in accepting circumstantial evidence in one case. And there was, I'll not detail it, would be reported judgment. There was one circumstance which was a clincher. There was one circumstance which was a clincher, at least to me. And therefore, I can do. Normally, otherwise, one should hesitate. One should hesitate unless, as it says, if there's absolutely no escape from the conclusion, yes, conviction can be based on circumstantial evidence. The law permits it and it should be done. Not a crime that is committed away from the eyes of witnesses should not go unpunished if one can prove it. But yes, we should not prove convict an innocent because nobody has seen who has done it. Merely to satisfy the as I may call it, a thirst to punish, bloodthirsty society that now some wrong has been done, so it must be punished. Can't pick out some innocent and punish the person. Yes, somebody else is asking.
Yes, Your Lordship. This one question in the chat box from Karan. He's asking, what would be your view on the right to self-defense extending to another person? Could the courts even consider the discharge of the accused without having a trial, as the accused may accept all the charges against him or her, but may continue pleading on the right to self-defense?
Frankly speaking, on private defense, well, I think that it is a very valuable right. And again, there are some views which people, lawyers, judges might hold privately, but generally, whenever a defense of this private defense is taken, it is tried. Except for police officers, nobody else is discharged. But I think that yes, persons should be discharged if it is so glaringly clear that some intruder has entered your house in the night at 2 p.m. with a gun and you have shot him. Maybe because he was going to attack your child, or maybe he was going to attack some other family member, or maybe any unconnected person who was there, a friend or a guest or a servant. Yes, I think one should have take a holistic view. But the practice is that in such matters, the defense is put to trial. I remember an old incident which was just to be on the slightly hilarious side, so that we leave. There was a very renowned lawyer from the districts who was elevated as a high court judge, I think in the 50s or 60s, Justice Gangeshwar Prasad. So when he was a district court lawyer, he was conducting criminal and civil cases both. So the case was that, as I said, in the night, some intruder had entered the house and the man in self-defense took out his licensed gun and he shot him. And the single shot was fatal. The man died, the intruder died. So the prosecution were arguing that he had exceeded his right of self-defense. So the learned judge, as the counsel as he then was, he said that, he said, Your Honor, he was before the trial judge, not in the High Court. He said that, Your Honor, my client, what could he do? He never exceeded his right. he fired a single shot and the man died. Your Honor would agree that my client could not have fired a half shot. What lesser than a single shot? Couldn't be a half shot. So I believe that if there's a respectable man, he's not a criminal. He's inside his home, and an intruder enters, and he has his licensed weapon. He tries to save his family. And if in the process the man dies, then why unnecessarily try him? But generally speaking, what happens is the practice is that they're put on trial. But I think that, yes, should be discharged. If it is sufficiently proved, Section 227 of the CRPC gives ample power to the sessions judge to find that the charge is groundless.
Thank you, Your Lordship. There are more questions. So, however, I'll pick up this very inquisitive question from one of the, aspirants. He or she has asked, how should a judiciary aspirant approach the subject of evidence law apart from reading the judgments and the Bayer Act, how to absorb the maximum of this of the essence of this act, the subject? So, Your Lordship, if you answer this, I think we are right on time then.
Well, that is a... The answer is very simple, but to act on that answer is very difficult. The simple answer is practice law. When you enter the court, you will learn it. But an aspirant to the judicial service, whether that time he can or she can spare that time, I do not know. Therefore, I say that it is difficult to act. There's no other way.
Your Lordship. With this, we come to an end of today's lecture. On behalf of Jindal Global Law School, OP Jindal Global University, I thank Honorable Mr. Justice Munir for kindly agreeing to grace us with his presence and delivering today's lecture, explaining to us at length the importance of Evidence Act concepts from Judiciary Services examination point of view. The lecture surely was an amazing refresher for everyone who's already studied the subject and a guide for the ones who are yet to study the subject. Your Lordship, we look forward to hosting you again. And I take this opportunity to announce that the next lecture is scheduled for the 3rd of October 2021, Sunday, from 12 p.m. to 1 p.m., wherein Professor Dr. Anju Tyagi from National Law University, Delhi, will be giving an overview on the Hindu law. Flyers and links will be circulated shortly. Take care and have a great weekend. Thank you. Thank you, sir.